About 4 weeks ago, maybe 5 weeks ago, I had a very revealing experience. It was a Sunday morning. We were getting ready to leave for church, and my phone popped up with a notification, happily letting me know that my daily average screen time usage was down 10% from the prior week to a total of 2.5 hours a day. I was completely shocked by this news. 2.5 hours a day, and it was down 10% from last week. What was it last week? How much was I on my phone? Sam, my son, was standing next to me, kind of looking over my shoulder when this thing popped up, because of course my phone was in my hand when it came up. Irony of ironies. So Sam was looking at me, and he said, he pointed to the screen, and he said, "That's embarrassing." Oh, the sting of conviction. My own children know something very true that this thing revealed about me. What that screen time notification revealed is that I'm a pretty distracted person. And I'm sure that we all have stories like this. Distraction just abounds in our society. Your attention is one of the hottest commodities on the market. Countless organizations and pretty much every single one of your devices is on a quest to get your attention all at once. And the result is a very fractured state of mind. It's kind of like you took a rope and just frayed all the ends of it. When you're distracted, you feel like your attention is being pulled in multiple directions, just torn into pieces all at one time. So distraction is certainly not healthy for us. But at the same time, distraction is in vogue. Even though it's an unhealthy lifestyle, it's usually one that we have chosen for ourselves. Multitasking makes us feel productive. Busyness makes us feel important. Distractions help us cope with the challenges of life. We turn to our devices to help us through stress or sadness or anxiety or even boredom. And so even though it's a toxic state of mind, it's usually self-inflicted. We in the church usually like to say that we're quite different from the culture. I think one of our aspirations is to be different from the world around us as Christians, but I kind of wonder if on the distraction front, we have given ourselves a pass. Do we think of distraction as a spiritual problem or merely just a modern phenomenon that we need to learn how to deal with? The journalist Bonnie Christian writes, "Attention is integral to discipleship. I'm increasingly convinced the sheer availability of content, particularly political content, designed to inflame our worst passions, may be the most unprecedented challenge in Christian discipleship today." So attention is part of our discipleship. And if that's the case, how does the Bible speak into this reality? How does the Bible help us with distraction? Well, enter Psalm 84, our psalm for the day. Psalm 84 is a psalm of pilgrimage. It's a psalm of longing to be at home with the Lord, and at the same time, it's a psalm of attention. It teaches us how to pay attention to God on the way to the Lord. It's precisely the pilgrim's attention to God that sustains the pilgrim's journey to God. Psalm 84 helps us pay attention to God in the middle of a culture and a world full of distractions. Now, as we look at the world around us, there are other people who recognize that distraction's a problem. And one of the common solutions or answers to the problem of distraction is mindfulness. People will say, oh, you should just practice some mindfulness. And Psalm 84 agrees with that to an extent. We hear an interesting word from Psalm 84 with a biblical twist on it. Here's Psalm 84's answer to distraction. We need to cultivate heavenly mindfulness. We need heavenly mindfulness. For healthy spirituality in a culture of distraction, we need to develop heavenly mindfulness. And Psalm 84 teaches us exactly how to do that. And so, brothers and sisters, please turn your attention with me to God's holy word as he speaks to us. Please give this your attention this morning. How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. My soul longs, yes, faints for the courts of the Lord. My heart and flesh sing for joy to the living God. Even the sparrow finds a home, and the swallow a nest for herself where she may lay her young. At your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God, blessed are those who dwell in your house, ever singing your praise. Blessed are those whose strength is in you, in whose heart are the highways to Zion. As they go through the valley of Baca, they make it a place of springs. The early rain also covers it with pools. They go from strength to strength. Each one appears before God in Zion. O Lord God of hosts, hear my prayer. Give ear, O God of Jacob. Behold our shield, O God. Look on the face of your anointed. For a day in your courts is better than a thousand elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of wickedness. For the Lord God is a sun and a shield. The Lord bestows favor and honor. No good thing does he withhold from those who walk uprightly. O Lord of hosts, blessed is the one who trusts in you. Brothers and sisters, thus far in the reading of God's word, the grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. Let's pray. Our Lord, we thank you for this beautiful word, a healing word, a wholesome word that calls us to be wholehearted. Would you unite our hearts and our minds so that we would fear your name? And speak to us now. Break through our distractions so that we could hear your voice. And because surely our attention is frayed and our hearts are longing for home. So be with us now, we pray. Through your gracious word and through your Holy Spirit, we ask in the name of Christ. Amen. So how can we cultivate heavenly mindfulness? The first thing that we need to do, according to Psalm 24, or 84, excuse me, is to name our earthly distractions. We need to name earthly distractions. Like the psalmist, we are pilgrims journeying towards God, and there are distractions along the way that can cause us to forget where we're going. Have you ever been walking through your house, going to a specific room for a specific purpose to get a specific thing, and then you show up in that room and you can't remember why you're there? You knew you were walking there for a reason, but you just cannot recall the reason that you were going on that journey. Now, we cannot afford to do that in our relationship with God. When we are journeying towards God, we cannot forget the reason that we are going there. We can't forget our purpose. And so we need to understand where we're going. And so the reason, the first way that we can help keep our focus on God, cultivating that heavenly mindfulness, is to name the distractions in our lives so that they don't overpower us and overpower our attention. The psalmist names two potent distractions in our pilgrimage. Here are the two potent distractions: our circumstances and counterfeits. So circumstances and counterfeits can distract us on our way to the Lord. Our circumstances can certainly distract us on our journey. The pilgrims in this psalm are journeying through the Valley of Baca that we hear. And now that phrase, Valley of Baca, could mean two different things. Literally, you could translate it the Valley of Baca, meaning a valley filled with trees that thrive in a very dry condition. And so you can imagine what this valley would look like if it's filled with trees that thrive only in dry conditions. You'd be traveling through a really rugged and dry and hot valley. And on the other hand, another way we could translate this would be the valley of tears, or the valley of weeping, so a hard place that would signify emotional challenges on the way. And with either one of those meanings, whether we translate it more of a physical dryness for the pilgrim walking through, or we understand it as an emotionally hard place on our pilgrimage, the valley of Baca hurts, and it's a challenge to our discipleship. When we're in hard circumstances, it's very, very easy for us to focus so much on those circumstances that we forget where we're going. Maybe you've lost a job, or maybe finances are really tight, or maybe you've had a falling out with a friend, or experienced the sting of betrayal, or maybe it's just some of the stuff that we're going through in our time of COVID. Now, you're in the dry valley at that point in time. You're in the place of tears. And in order for those circumstances to not distract you, you need to know what they are. And you need to remember what your primary purpose is. Your primary purpose, even in the valley, is growing in godliness. Our circumstances can distract us from that primary purpose of growing in godliness. Counterfeits can also distract us. Counterfeits resemble the gifts of God, but they fail to really deliver. And in this psalm, the counterfeits are coming from the tents of wickedness that we hear of in verse 10, these tents of wickedness. The psalmist compares being a doorkeeper in the house of God to dwelling in the tents of wickedness. And let's pay attention to what that comparison looks like. A doorkeeper would literally be someone sort of just on the threshold. It'd be an incredibly lowly position, never fully on the inside, always just on the threshold. Now compare that to the tents of wickedness. What would the tents of wickedness be able to offer to this psalmist who's thirsty, going through the dry valley towards God? What would tents of wickedness offer? Well, here's what the tents of wickedness offer. They offer stability. We hear about dwelling. Of course, someone who's on a pilgrimage would like to dwell somewhere. To have the pilgrimage be over, the tents offer some stability to a pilgrim on the way. They also offer community. At these tents, you would find like-minded people, a tribe to help you, someone to hang out with, to have a shared sense of purpose. Maybe it's very lonely on this journey that the psalmist is going on. The tents of wickedness would offer prosperity. These tents evoke sort of wealth and grandness that we might see in the ancient Near East. Of these large tents where the people would dwell. So there's prosperity there, and there's also status. Maybe a modern translation, if we wanted to riff off of the tents of wickedness, could be the halls of power, dwelling in the halls of power. And if you dwell in the halls of power, you're really somebody. You're not some no-name doorkeeper, just always on the fringes. So stability, community, prosperity, status. Who wouldn't want that? But consider the source. Consider where that is coming from. It's coming from the tents of wickedness. And we know throughout the scriptures that the tents of wickedness will ultimately have a downfall. There's a downfall to these tents. They can never actually deliver what they are giving. They don't fulfill their promises. Their offerings won't last. And so when you dwell in the tents of wickedness, you end up in a destructive spiral. You pursue the counterfeit offerings again and again and again, and maybe you enjoy a momentary respite from a hard journey, but there is no lasting comfort. If we train our minds and our bodies to crave these counterfeits, we're going to be stuck with a bunch of empty promises. And so hear the wisdom of the psalmist. Godliness is better than counterfeits. Godliness is better than counterfeit stability, community, prosperity, or status. So what are our counterfeits? Where are you tempted to pursue stability, or community, or prosperity, or status apart from God? It might be from work, or social media, or from political leaders or civic organizations that you're a part of, or maybe even in your own home. Our habits usually give us away. They're the things that can tell us where we're pursuing counterfeits, when notifications bring us more joy than real relationships, or when email takes precedence over prayerfulness, or if the state of our household or the cleanliness of our household takes precedence or is more important than the godliness of our home, then we've probably been distracted by counterfeits. And these distractions will destroy our relationship with God. And so you need to name the distractions. Name those circumstances and the counterfeits that distract you from your pilgrimage so that these things do not master you. Is it loneliness? Is it a habitual consumption of political commentary? Is it using social media to try and find meaning or validation or significance? What is it for you? What are your distractions that you tend to indulge? And if you don't know right offhand, you might need some help. You should ask a loved one, a close friend, and they might be able to tell you a little bit more. If you ask them, what distracts my attention from the most important things? Because we all struggle with some of these things. And so ask a friend, ask a loved one to give you some perspective into your life. Remember, we are pilgrims. We're journeying towards God on a daunting, challenging, and dangerous trail. So be aware of your surroundings and point out the distractions so that you don't fall off of the path. Name your earthly distractions and then fixate on heavenly blessings. That's step two. Fixate on heavenly blessings. It's not just enough to notice the dangers. You need to fill your mind with visions of the destination, where you're going. Imagine that you were driving down the road. You have a dinner reservation at a Michelin 3-star restaurant. So the pinnacle in culinary expertise, and you are starving. You're driving down the road, and you pass a gas station. In that gas station, you know that your favorite candy bar is in there for a dollar. Well, how are you going to avoid pulling off the road for that quick bite of candy just to satisfy your hunger? What you do is you imagine how wonderful your dinner's going to be. You think about your destination, and you fill your mind with how amazing it will be to sit at that restaurant and dine there. Those visions of your destination can help you beat through the temptation to come off the path and get some sort of cheap substitute that'll fill you up but won't really satisfy you. And so in our discipleship journey to the Lord, we need to do the same thing. We need to fixate on heavenly blessings. The psalmist is hungry for God. He is practically withering with desire to be with God. Verse 1, how lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. My soul longs, yes, faints for the courts of the Lord. We could translate the second part of that, my heart and flesh cry out for the living God. He's on a journey, and he is hungry. And so how does he sustain that hunger through the journey? Well, he fills his mind with heavenly blessings. And so here are three heavenly blessings that we can look forward to enjoying when we are at home with God in our heavenly dwelling place. So here's blessing number one. Blessing number one, you will behold God. You will behold God. And I really could just stop there. That's the biggest blessing that you could want. The Lord God is a sun, as we hear in the text. He is a brilliant personal presence of splendor and glory. To behold God is bedazzling. It's completely enriching. If you're at his house, you will behold his presence. And if that doesn't sound amazing, then one of the things we should reflect on is that we may have spent so long in this world indulging in little distractions that we've lost sight for how big and wonderful God is. God is truly amazing. And if we think too little of him, then being in his presence and beholding him isn't that great. But when we realize how full of life the Lord is, it is glorious to stand in his presence, to behold his glory without being consumed by it. We'll stand in the presence of the sun without being burned up. It's going to be wonderful. And that's just the start. That's just the first blessing. Here's blessing number two. You will belong in his house. You will belong in God's house. Human beings crave belonging. Look at all the things that we do to try and fit in. We will alter our behavior. We will spend lots of money on different kinds of wardrobes just to fit in. And tragically, we often feel like, despite our best efforts, we never quite belong. But with God, we will finally belong. Verse 3, even the sparrow finds a home, and a swallow a nest for herself where she may lay her young at your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. God apparently delights in these insignificant, tiny birds. He welcomes them to find a place in his house. How much more so will he welcome you, a child of God, a son or daughter of the King? He will welcome you into his house. You will belong, and there will be no more wandering. Your pilgrimage will be over because you'll be home. That's the second blessing. You'll belong in his house. And blessing number three is you will benefit from his grace. When you behold God, and when you belong in his house, tremendous blessings gush into your life. Listen to verse 4. Blessed are those who dwell in your house, ever singing your praise. Blessed or happy, we could translate it. Same word. Happy are those who are in the presence of the Lord. Now, why are they happy? Why are they blessed? Look at verse 11. The Lord God is a sun and a shield. The Lord bestows favor and honor. No good thing does he withhold from those who walk uprightly. It's tremendous benefits that God gives us. Now think about those other counterfeit things that we're tempted by. Stability, community, prosperity, status. It sounds like God is ready to give us all of those blessings. He is ready to give us all of those things. And unlike the tents of wickedness, when God gives them, they will last. God will give us everything that we could hope for when we are in his presence. And so to cultivate heavenly mindfulness in the midst of a distracting world, fixate on these heavenly blessings. You'll behold God. You will belong in his house, and you will benefit from his grace. Fill your mind with those. Fill your house with those. Pick some scriptures that describe how amazing heaven is going to be. Or how amazing God is. And then think about that you will dwell in that God's presence. Write it down on some sticky notes or put it on an index card and put it in your pocket. Carry it with you. Fill your life with it. Let God's word disciple your attention. Overcome your distractions with God's promises. So if you are lonely now, you will finally belong. God will welcome you into his presence, and you will have an eternal community of saints to enjoy God with, glorifying him forever together. If you're driven to distraction by the news, remember where your true citizenship lies. You are a citizen of heaven, where there is a perfect king and an unshakable kingdom. There is nothing to fear because our citizenship is with God. It will be perfect unity and perfect harmony in our heavenly dwelling place with the Lord. So keep the end in mind. Cultivate heavenly mindfulness by fixating on heaven, and then savor those blessings now. That's step three. Savor heavenly blessings now. When was the last time that you truly savored something? Recently, we took our kids to try gelato for the first time. And that's an exercise in savoring something. Have you ever had gelato before? It's an incredibly rich and incredibly flavorful thing. And they give it to you in these tiny little portions. And they give you these incredibly small spoons. And so what you have to do is savor it. The best thing that you could do is just put little bits in your mouth and just kind of let it melt in your mouth. That is savoring something. It is a slow, purposeful enjoyment. We don't tend to savor things in our world, especially out here. We live in an incredibly busy part of the world. We don't tend to savor things. We take our food to go, we wolf it down on our way to the next thing, and we don't just do that with food. We do it with all kinds of stuff. We binge on entertainment. If you're watching Netflix and your show ends, the next one is queued up in 5 seconds. Before the credits are even done, you're ready to get on to the next thing. We do that with our relationships. We go from conversation to conversation. We have a constant distraction around us if we have our phones on our person or even just in our proximity. See, we don't savor things in our world. But here's what you do when you savor something. It actually transforms the moment. It's something that is very satisfying now. You sit for a moment and just enjoy it. And that gives you a sense of peace and calm, even in the midst of a lot of craziness. And here's what happens when you savor heavenly blessings. If it's great to savor gelato, let's just think about how wonderful it is to savor heavenly blessings. That future glory that you're thinking about and meditating on, what happens is it comes into your life even now. You get a taste of those heavenly joys even in the midst of the valley of dryness. And that is actually all through this psalm. The pilgrims on the way get to enjoy heaven just like the people who are there. We heard in verse 4, the people who have arrived in heaven, who are dwelling in the house of God, they are happy, they are blessed. But listen to verse 5. Blessed are those whose strength is in you, in whose heart are the highways to Zion. Or verse 12, O Lord of hosts, blessed is the one who trusts in you. Now these are the pilgrims on the way. They're on the way to God. And so that sense of blessedness is with them too. Even in our current experience, we can enjoy a taste of heaven even now. And that has great things for our journey. Verse 7, they go from strength to strength. Each one appears before God in Zion. Meaning that the pilgrims who are savoring God on the way, those people who are blessed on their way to great blessing, they are strengthened. They go from strength to strength so that they make it all the way home to God in heaven. So let's recall our heavenly blessings: beholding, belonging, and benefiting. The good news is that you can savor those things now. You can begin to enjoy those heavenly blessings even now. You can savor them now through Christ. Listen to verse 9. Behold our shield, O God. Look on the face of your anointed. Now that is a prayer that God would bless the Davidic king. God's blessings in the Old Testament flowed to the people from the Davidic king. It was like the Davidic king was a conduit for all of God's blessings to the people. And Jesus fulfills that vocation. Jesus is great David's greater son. Jesus now sits on the throne of David. He is the Messiah. He is the anointed one, God's anointed one. And the Lord God looks upon his face. And Jesus now is the conduit of all of those heavenly blessings into our lives. Jesus is the mediator of every rich and glorious heavenly gift to us. And we can have it now. Through Jesus, we can behold God. We can see God's glory even now. Through Jesus, we belong in God's presence. Jesus welcomes us into the throne room of God. Even now, Jesus, through his Spirit, is with us. You belong in God's presence. He's here now. He is speaking to you through his word. You belong here. And through Jesus, all of God's rich and glorious blessings flow into our lives, and we can benefit from every single one of God's graces. And so you can savor a taste of heaven even now through Christ. Every time you pray in his name, every time you reflect on the gospel, these are ways that you can get in touch with the God who lives in heaven, but is with you now through the Holy Spirit. Jesus died for you. Jesus was raised from the dead for you, and he lives now to intercede for you. Christ loves you. Let the gospel be this wonderful blessing in your life. Again, a taste of heaven. Savor heaven now through Christ. You can also savor a taste of heavenly blessings now through prayer. We hear the pilgrim pray in verse 8, O Lord God of hosts, hear my prayer. Give ear, O God of Jacob. Now, if you remember my definition of prayer from way back in the prayer series, here's what it was. Prayer is accessing God's presence and power by asking in faith. So we have a direct line to our Heavenly Father's presence. We have a direct line to the throne room of heaven, even though we're still journeying now. It's like we've got Jesus' cell phone number, kind of, so to speak. You can talk to God now. You have his number, and so take advantage of it. Spend some time in prayer. Savor heaven now through prayer. Savor heaven now also through the Bible. This is God's holy word to you, and the Spirit works through it. See, the Bible doesn't just tell us true things about God. The Spirit works through it to make those true things come alive in our hearts and in our minds. It puts the highway of Zion deep within our hearts so that we can experience blessing as we're going on the path to heaven. And finally, we can savor heavenly blessings now through the church. The psalmist longs to be in God's presence, where God's glory dwells. He longs to be in the courts of God. And where is that now? Well, it's the church. It's the people of God. We are the temple. We're the place where God's glory sits. He dwells with us now through the Holy Spirit. And so in our community now, in our shared fellowship now, we can experience a foretaste of our heavenly fellowship. And of course, it'll be imperfect now. We see through a glass darkly. Our minds are very distracted. Our attention spans are weak. But just because it's hard and just because it's imperfect doesn't mean it's not true. The Lord is with us, and it will take some effort, though, I think, to dig out those blessings and to savor the heavenly blessings that we have with God. And so here's how we can do this. How are you going to make it? How are you going to enjoy these blessings now? You need to make space in your life. You need to make space to savor heaven with the Lord now, these heavenly blessings that Jesus pours out into our life. So you need to make space in your life. You need to make space in your schedule. You need to block off some times or make some calendar appointments for yourself. Set an alarm to remind you to pray. Put down your book or turn off your TV just a few minutes early at the end of the day. Or put away your email just a few minutes early and maybe end every day with a psalm. So that you are regularly reminding yourself of the blessings that God gives to you. Maybe you need to find some time with a Christian friend. And when you're in this time with a Christian friend, put away your phones and put them totally away from you. Turn them off so that you can be 100% present with each other. Make space in your life. Make space in your mind. Make space in your heart. Name your stress or your sadness or your boredom and ask God to remove it. You can train your mind to be more focused during prayer. You can train your heart to crave God's affirmation instead of the affirmation and validation that can come to us from the world. If distraction is something that we have learned, it's something that we can unlearn, and we can look for new habits that can help us focus on God. Make space in your mind and your heart. And then finally, just make space in your attention. It is possible to commune with God throughout the day. Even if your life is incredibly busy, when you're at school, where you're at work, you can take little moments to turn your attention briefly to God. And you can say just small prayers, things like, Jesus, help me. Holy Spirit, be with me now. God, I thank you for your presence. Just those little tiny moments of plugging our attention back into God can sustain us. So as we make space in our life to savor these heavenly blessings, you will experience God. God will heal your divided attention. God will bless you with strength. He will fill you with grace and glory, and God will transform you to be a blessing of healing to others. See, heavenly mindfulness isn't just about you experiencing a taste of heaven now. It actually transforms the landscape around you so that those heavenly blessings stay. It's like irrigating a dry land. When we cultivate heavenly mindfulness for ourselves, we are actually cultivating the world around us too, so that when God sends his rain of blessing, the valleys of dryness and weeping become overwhelmed with the presence of God. And that's actually in this psalm. This is the promise of verse 6. As they go through the valley of Baca, they make it a place of springs. Or as another translation puts it, they make it a source of spring water. Even the autumn rain will cover it with blessings. Just imagine what that would look like in our fragmented and distracted world. If we silenced our phones, if we stopped accepting counterfeits, if we made space for God instead of indulging distractions, we'd actually be more present for others. We'd likely be more patient with others. Our tempers would cool down. Our relationships would become others-centered because we don't need that other person for validation anymore. We are then free to serve them. We're free to bless them and love them. Our aspirations would shift. Instead of seeking status, we would seek to build other people up. Instead of seeking earthly wealth, what we would do is enjoy the heavenly wealth that God gives to us. Now think about that. What a redemptive vision of society the Bible gives to us. And I think it reminds us of someone, doesn't it? Who does that sound like? Well, it sounds like Jesus. See, Jesus was the pinnacle of someone who was heavenly mindful. Jesus was fully present with those around, even while he was fully connected to the Lord. He was others-centered. He built up other people to the point of sacrificing himself. Jesus gave himself for us. And so, because Jesus is the picture of heavenly mindfulness, when we cultivate heavenly mindfulness, we become like him. And then his blessings flow through us to the world around us. They make it, that dry valley, they make it a source of spring water. Even the autumn rain will cover it with blessings. So what are we to do about our distraction? Will we submit our attention to God's discipleship, or will we go back to our distracted ways? Let me challenge you this week to really focus on God. Really focus on God. Put away your distractions and follow Christ. In an age of distraction, heavenly mindfulness is healing. It's the taste of heaven on earth. Let's pray. Lord, we do thank you for your word. And we ask that through it, you would continue to heal our attentions. As we attend to you this week, I pray that your Spirit would give us everything we need. Be to us our God and keeper. We pray in the name of Christ. Amen.